Kate trained in biological anthropology at Cambridge, nutritional sciences at Cornell, and epidemiology at UC Berkeley. She is currently Professor of Epidemiology in the Department of Health Sciences at the University of York, and a research champion for justice and equality. She is co-author with Rachel Wilkinson of The Spirit Level, chosen as one of the top 10 books of the decade by The New Statesman, winner of the Publication of the Year by the Political Studies Association, and translated into 23 languages. The book puts inequality at the centre of public debate by showing conclusively that less equal societies fare worse than more equal ones across everything from education to life expectancy. Her recent book, The Inner Level, got published in 2018 and explains how inequality affects us more individually. More specifically, how social anxieties and the problems they lead to rise steadily in more unequal societies. For her work, Kate has been consulted at local, national and international levels. She is co-founder and trustee of the Equality Trust, which is focused on improving the quality of life in the UK by reducing economic and social inequality.
Thank you so much. Thank you for introducing me so nicely. Thank you for inviting me. Thank you all for being here on a cold, wet and rainy night. I'm always amazed that anybody will go out, you know, to hear people talk about ideas or science or something rather than staying at home and watching the television. I never go out. So thank you all for coming. It's a real pleasure to be here. Also, I was a student here at Cambridge a long time ago, and I'm staying tonight in my old college. I'll be sleeping in a little single bed and, you know, behaving like I always did, probably getting told off by the head porter. But it's really nice to be back here. Also, I've lost my memory stick. So I've got a reduced set of slides, which means I will talk more and show less, I'm afraid. There we go. So, I'm an epidemiologist. Most of you probably know what an epidemiologist is, right? But most people in the world don't. So if I'm on a flight and I'm just having a chat with someone next to me and they say, what do you do? And I say, I'm an epidemiologist, they say, oh, skin. Yeah. I mix up the deem with the dermos. I have to sort of say, no. But epidemiologists study the distribution and the determinants of states of health, well-being, and disease. Populations. So it's sort of like doctors, but we don't focus on the individual, we focus on sections of the population. And together with Richard Wilkinson, I've been working on the impact of income inequality on health and well-being of populations for a long time. And what I want to describe for you tonight is what we found, why we think it's important, and what might be done about it. But basically, what we're trying to do is understand levels of well-being in different populations. Now, I'm not sure I can do this. This is how we think we should be, right? Happy, connected to one another, good-looking, healthy. You know, this is how we should be in the world. This is our image of how we should be. This is actually an advert for a psychotherapy clinic in California. So these people are probably not quite as happy as they look. What we're actually like... So this is a picture taken of young people going to work. This is outside Oxford Street tube station in London. So everyone's employed, they're all on the way to a job, they are uniformly miserable. Some of them look angry, some of them look distressed, some of them look as if they're about to burst into tears. Nobody's talking to anyone unless it's on their mobile phone to somebody who's not there. And so what Rich and I have been trying to do is understand the disconnection between the way we think we ought to be in the world and the way the world is. Why is it that so many of us are unhappy, distressed, lacking well-being when we in the UK live in the fifth richest economy in the world? If you'd ask our grandparents, you all look a lot younger than me, so maybe great-grandparents, but if you'd ask them, what would life be like when you always lived in a house that was warm, dry, you had enough food, you had access to transport, health care, all of this, they would think we'd be living in some kind of paradise. And yet we have an epidemic of mental illness, distress, anxiety, depression, etc. So it's trying to understand that. Now, epidemiologists, what we do is we don't consult with an individual patient and figure out their symptoms and what's wrong with them. We use statistics. We gather data on different groups and we compare those groups on different dimensions. Guess what? Most people don't love statistics. I love statistics. I didn't when I was younger, but when I finally kind of got to grips with them, I was like, oh, it's a whole new world. Statistics are like a microscope for society, you know? If you're a biologist, you're a microscope and you look down and little thing. Statistics are a social microscope that allow you to see differences between populations, but most people don't love them. And when we were first trying to write about the impact of inequality on health for a general audience, we would use statistics and graphs and whatever, and we show them to some family and friends, and everybody hated them. So we have learned to be very simple in our presentation. So if you can understand this statistic or this chart, you can understand everything I'm going to show you. What we have found is that as income inequality increases in different societies, so do a whole raft of health and social problems. It feels simple, maybe simplistic, but actually, this chart is a sort of a hint of a whole raft of biological, psychological, and sociological pathways through which income inequality affects our health and well-being. Right, slightly more complicated. So on this one, what we're looking at is an index of health and social problems up the side against a measure of income inequality. So we've got the more equal societies on this side, on the left, Japan, Sweden, the Nordics, and more unequal societies over here, on the right, the USA, Portugal, and the UK. And we're comparing them on an index of health and social problems. We created this index based on looking for things that are measured well in different societies and that have social problems. So they're more common at the bottom of society, less common at the top. And there's really three kinds of things in this index of health and social well-being. One is health. So we've got measures of life expectancy, infant mortality, mental illness, and that includes drug and alcohol problems in this measure, obesity. So measures of physical and mental health all get worse as inequality rises. We've also got measures of things that economists call human capital development, but I would call children's life chances. So we've got educational attainment at age 15, maths and literacy scores, we've got teenage pregnancy rates, we've got social mobility. Can you move up or down in society? And then the third kind of things are to do with our social relationships, how we relate to one another. So we've got trust. In more equal societies, more people feel they can trust others. Not people they know, but just people in general. That's really important. Imagine you are a woman child on the playground, are you bullied or not? What's it like to be in public transport? What are relationships like at work? If you're a young man walking down the street and you see another group of young men on the corner, is that a threat or is it potentially going to be okay? So trust really matters. We've also got a measure of homicide rates in different countries, levels of imprisonment. These are all measures of social relationships. I think the key, though, to understanding how inequality affects us is its effect on our minds. And so I'm just going to show you the impact of inequality on mental illness. So here we're looking at the prevalence of mental illness upside. These are data taken in the World Health Organization and other surveys, where they go out and get random samples of the adult population and they attempt to discover whether they've got some kind of mental illness or not. And people used to think you couldn't do this because it's too culturally specific whether people who describe themselves or be diagnosed with having a mental illness. But in these studies, what they do is they ask people about symptoms. So they don't ask them, are you depressed or has a doctor ever diagnosed you as depressed? They ask you, have you been tired in the last few weeks? Have you been low? They ask about symptoms and they amalgamate those into categories of mental illness. And when they do that, we get a prevalence of mental illness in different societies. And so in the more equal ones, on the left, less than 10% of the adult population has some kind of mental illness in the past year. In the more unequal societies, on the right, it's 23% for Australia and the UK, 26% for the USA. So a quarter of the population in America having some kind of mental illness in the past year. Now, when we first published this in the British Journal of Psychiatry, somebody wrote into the journal and said we were mad, supposed to be mentally ill, for thinking that 23% of the British population had some kind of mental illness in the past year. They said that we were pathologizing normal reactions to life, distress, anxiety, whatever, and that this number was wrong. But I think they were barking up the wrong tree. Because the question is not whether 23% is the right number for the UK. It might be a little bit higher, might be a little bit lower. If I think about myself, my family, my friends, my colleagues, I should probably be higher than 23%. But it doesn't matter if it's a little bit off. What matters are the differences between the countries and the way they relate to inequality. And when we have these data and can see this pattern, we started to think about what is it that causes this? Why are more people more distressed in more unequal societies and less distressed in more equal ones? And when we wrote our 2009 book, what we were doing was relying on experiments with students, experiments with monkeys, all kinds of bits of evidence to help us think about what was causing this. And we theorized at that point that it was anxiety about status in more unequal societies that was leading to this level of distress. That was our hypothesis, that was what we thought. And I can remember going to America after the Spirit of the College to go and talk at the University of Chicago, where I was being an assistant professor for 4 years. And I knew what it was going to be like. They're really, really horrible when you're doing a seminar there. They jump in with questions immediately. And we presented our stuff and they said that you have no prevalent in more unequal societies. And they were right, we haven't. But now somebody else, my goodness, has. Mm-hmm. So, here we are. These are data from Late and Whelan, colleagues in Ireland, and they are looking at reported anxiety about status, upside, in relation to people's incomes. So we've got the poorest people in society over here on the left, and the richest people in society over here on the right. If you're poor, of course you're more worried about status. But in more unequal societies, the top line, everyone is more anxious about their status. And in low inequality countries, everybody is less worried. So we see these effects at greatest for the poorest, but they go all the way up to society. And knowing that, we can then think about, well, how do people react to that anxiety about status across the whole society? If income inequality is greater, the social life is steeper, the rungs of the fall apart, and everybody's more worried about status, what does that do? And it turns out that it has multiple different effects. We don't all react the same way. So some of us sort of go out of it. We're worried about how we're seen. We'll experience ourselves through the eyes of other people. Some people in a more unequal society will see that as a weight, an oppressive downward thing. They will feel that they are not up to living a good life. They will feel they're not good enough. And so we see that inequality is linked to higher levels of depression. These are the data in the United States. We see it for anxiety as well. So we see more of that downward angst, that worry about how we're seen in more unequal societies. And people withdraw from social interaction more. So this is a measure of civic participation. If you live in a more unequal society, you are less likely to vote, to read a newspaper, to engage with your neighbours, to join in with community events. You're less likely to participate in society. In more equal societies, people participate more. And we see the same for cultural participation as well. You're less likely to go to the theatre, to the ballet, to the opera, to an art gallery, to a museum, to take part in cultural activities if you live in a more unequal society than if you live in a more equal one. It's as if you feel that those things are not for you. Some of you might have heard about the British class survey that was run by professors at the London School of Economics. It was an online survey. People were asked to say what they did with their time and what they bought and all of that. And it differentiated people into different classes. And after they ran that survey, there was a sudden increase in people buying theatre tickets in London, because people realised that buying a theatre ticket, going to the theatre, made you a higher class. So more people went to the theatre after that. We see lower levels of social solidarity in more unequal societies. So people are less willing to help their neighbours, look after elderly people, you know, check out what's going on with their neighbours. And a student of mine recently showed that you're less likely in an unequal society to say that you're comfortable talking to somebody who's got a mental illness. So that kind of stigma, that downward prejudice, gets increased in more unequal societies. So lots of downward pressure in unequal societies, but not everybody reacts that way. Some people sort of do the opposite. The Chinese call it saving face. In Britain, we tend to call it bigging yourself up. You know, there's lots of words for the ways in which some people present themselves to others as really, really great. This is a cartoon we found a long time ago, but it reminds people quite a lot of a current world leader. when we first published the Spirit Level, we did get attacked quite a lot. People said, you know, dates are not right, and they're making things up, and we were asked by our publishers to respond to those criticisms with an extra chapter in a later edition. And one of the things I did when we were asked by that chapter, I would go and look and see if there are new studies of the link between inequality and health, and see what they show. I found 9 new studies comparing inequality in different countries and a measure of health. 7 of them showed what we found: greater inequality, worse health. 2 of them did not, and that worried me rather. Looked at it more closely and realized 7 that showed what we had found were measuring health objectively, life expectancy, mortality rates. The 2 that didn't were measuring self-rated health. And then Danny Dorling, close colleague and friend, professor in geography at the University of Oxford, took a look at the data and showed that actually, if you looked at income inequality in relation to life expectancy, goes like this, goes down as inequality rises. If you look at self-rated health, it does the opposite. So if we look at Japan, which has the highest life expectancy in the world, only 54% of people there think their health is good. If we look at America, which has the lowest life expectancy of the rich developed countries, more than 70% think their health is fabulous. We write about this as the late Wellbeing effect. Some of you might have heard Garrison Keillor, his American radio show, where he talks about a town where all of the children are above average. Can't be. But 96% of Americans think they are better drivers than average. You go to Sweden, only 66% of people think they're better drivers than average, which is still too high, but at least a bit more realistic. Because we've had an education secretary in the past, Michael Gove, who thought all of our schools should be above average. Maybe he should go back to school. But we do find now that self-enhancement is higher in more uneconomic societies. So these are data from a group of psychologists who survey people in different countries and ask them, are you a better driver than average? Are you a nicer person than average? Are you better looking than other people? Are you more intelligent than others? And more people in more unequal societies said they were fabulous. And this helps us to understand the data that come from the United States, which show that self-esteem is highest among African American men compared to African American women, white men, and white men. The group that experiences the most discrimination, the most prejudice, is actually saying they're doing okay. That's because our psychological measures of self-esteem don't actually measure what we think they measure. So if we think about what self-esteem really means, it should be a realistic assessment of our own capabilities, what we're good at and what we're not. You know, we should have a reflective, honest, and authentic assessment of our own capabilities. But the self-esteem measures don't measure that. They just measure people saying that they're doing fine. If about the narcissistic measures of how we think we're doing, then we find the relationships we would expect. So you won't be surprised to hear that narcissism has risen over time as inequality has risen in the United States. In fact, you can't use the standard psychological measure of self-esteem, the Rosenberg scale of self-esteem, in US high school and college populations anymore, because they all score at maximum. Jean Twenge has written a wonderful book about the rise of narcissism over time in the United States. It's quite fun to read, because actually, lots of the stories about narcissists are quite funny. So there was a woman who wanted her wedding cake baked in the shape of herself. There's a young woman who wanted the city to close down her high street and put out a red carpet so that she could be taken to her limousine to her prom. There are people you can hire to follow you and pretend that they are paparazzi and you're a celebrity, and you can hire them to, you know, follow you around and take pictures of you. So lots of sort of quite funny stories about narcissism. But actually, people who are narcissistic cause huge problems to themselves, their family, their friends, their colleagues. As I said, wouldn't it be terrible if a narcissist became a leader, a major country? And narcissists are not better at things than other people just think they are. So this is the real issue related to inequality. Some people go under, some people try to claw their way out. There's also, of course, always a third way. We've shown previously that income inequality is related to higher rates of problem alcohol use, illegal drug use, comfort eating, and now we have data on gambling, problem gambling. We would love to have data on video game addiction in young people, but it's not yet available for us. But when society becomes much more status-oriented, when money matters more, there are lots of things that people might do to try and either gain that status or alleviate their worries about having those problems. So we think now we've got a good picture of how income inequality is related to psychosocial health and well-being. We understand the biology of it, the biology of chronic stress. We understand how status differences between animals are linked to the kinds of responses that we see in human mental illness. There's lots of reasons why we might want to tackle income inequality just for those reasons. It creates lack of human well-being, poor social relationships, poor children's life chances. But actually, there are more reasons to care. If we live in societies that are more unequal, status matters more. There are bigger effects that really, really matter as we try to make the transition to more sustainable societies. We know now that not only does income inequality cause problems of addiction, drug use, shopping, comfort eating, it's also linked to status consumption and consumerism. People buy more status-related goods in more unequal societies. They search online for more status-oriented consumerist goods. So in unequal societies, we buy things we don't need, we money we don't have to impress people. And that is a major barrier to making that transition to more sustainable economies and dealing with our climate emergency. As well as understand the links between income inequality and the environment. It's not just that we buy more stuff that we don't need, that's one part, but also all of the things I talked about around social relationships mean that we're less likely to act collectively for the common good. So we see lower levels of recycling in more unequal societies, business people less likely to think that they should comply with environmental regulations. We see more water consumption per capita, more flights per capita, more meat consumption per capita, more CO2 put out into the atmosphere per capita in more unequal societies. So all of that's a huge problem. But also now we've got a lot of economists turning their attention to inequality and its impact. Nobel Prize winning economists telling us that economic growth and income inequality are not locked together. You can have economic growth in a more equal society. You don't have to sacrifice one for the other. And if you have greater inequality, then you have more cycles, boom and bust, more economic instability. It's harder to deal with poverty, it's harder to have a stable economy. So now we've got evidence from epidemiologists, sociologists about the ills of inequality. We've got data from environmental scientists linking inequality to lots of environmental measures. We've got measures from economists telling us there's no reason that we should prefer economic growth over income inequality reduction. So really, no reason not to do something about it. There's one big reason as well, and that's to do with democracy. If you have very unequal societies and vast numbers of people feeling left behind, that society is not looking after them, that policy and politics are not for them, then you create a vulnerability to populist messages and division in our democracies. This is a graph from The Economist, which is not well known as a very left-wing publication. But they were responding to a challenge about what factors best explain the swing from Democrats to Republicans in the election that brought Trump to the presidency. And the factor that they found most closely related to that swing from Democrats to Republicans was actually a measure of what's really held for inequality. So these data are for US counties. There are 3,000 and something counties in the US. The colors are for different regions, so don't worry about them. And the measure of health inequality it had was the prevalence of obesity, diabetes, heavy drinking, lack of physical exercise, and low life expectancy. And in counties that have more of that, and those are all things that are very unequally distributed, they're much more common at the bottom of society than at the top. In counties with more health inequality, more people voted for Trump in the selection than they voted for Democrat in the last one. It's a bit like what the Americans call turkeys voting for Thanksgiving. They were voting for an incoming president who's one of his top policy options was removing their right to health insurance. I've seen data linking income inequality to voting for populist right-wing parties in United States elections and in Europe over time. We're deeply divided in our own country at the moment over Brexit because I think a lot of people who voted to leave were feeling people in Trump's America left behind, that they didn't have chances, that politicians and policymakers were not looking after them. When we have a very unequal society, we risk our democracy. I don't want to end without hope. I do have a huge amount of hope, actually, which is mostly invested in our young people, lots of young people here today. Young people are concerned about these issues, they vote accordingly. We see huge interest among young people in more democracy, more progressive politics, caring about the environment and the climate emergency. So that's good. We used to think, Rich and I, that if we just got all this evidence together and put it out there, people would do something about it. Really wrong. So we set up a charity, the Equality Trust, to try and do something more concrete. It campaigns, tries to educate on lots of different issues. Please look it up online, you'd be very welcome. Come there and find out what you can do as an individual, or as an employee, as a citizen, to fight inequality. We work at local authority level, on fairness commissions. We work nationally, trying to bring poverty and inequality issues to the top of the agenda, and internationally as well. Within the Fight Inequality Alliance, the Equality Trust is the European convener for that. We sit on commissions at European level, at UN level, trying to make this happen. I spent 2 days in Rome earlier this week, in the Vatican. Very strange. As part of a commission that's been set up by Jeffrey Sachs, who is Professor of International Development in the US, in conjunction with the Pontifical Academies, which are the Vatican's universities, trying to bring people together to think about the science and the ethics and the faith of happiness and well-being, and trying to bring virtue back into economics, into economic thinking, economic planning, policy advice. That's going to be running over the next 2 years. Who knows? It could end up with a report that's just put on the shelf, like so many of the other things we've been involved with. But who knows? Sooner or later, one of these reports or commissions or endeavours is going to capture the imagination of the public. And we can never predict what that would be. Who could have imagined Greta Thunberg and the impact she would have? So maybe in the next 2 years we will have a movement, a populist, progressive movement that demands greater equality and greater well-being for all of us.
If anyone has any questions, feel free to raise your hand now and to ask them to Professor Pickett.
Thank you very much for the interesting talk. You presented a lot of data which shows a correlation between income inequality and various outcomes. Is there much robust evidence which shows that interventions or policies which have been introduced and successfully closed the inequality income gap and then results in improved health outcomes?
Yeah, really, really good question. So it's the causal question. Epidemiology is an observational science. We don't get to randomly assign different societies to be more equal or less equal and see what happens. But we can look historically, and we can look at time trends, and we can look longitudinally. The most interesting case is that of Japan and the United States. If you looked at their position in terms of health and income inequality just after the Second World War, you would have found Japan with the highest income inequality and the worst life expectancy, and America doing really well. They've now reversed. Japan's income equality policies were imposed, ironically, democracy from states that became more equal. We've got longitudinal studies that tell us how long it takes before income inequality changes and has an impact on mortality. Starts at 3 years, peaks at six, starts at 10 or 12. The specific policies, it's quite hard to say. You would need to ask an historian or a social policy historian rather than me. I mean, if we look at which countries continually do well, they are the Nordic countries in general. They score well on happiness, health, well-being of all kinds, and clearly their welfare systems are part of that. If we look at Latin American countries, we can see that those that had economic growth that was fairly evenly distributed had better health gains than those that had economic growth and didn't distribute it equally. So there's a range of evidence. I think the body of evidence is robust, but it doesn't tell us what exact policies are needed. So we have to be imaginative.
Just a quick question about the findings linking income inequality and narcissism, especially kind of inflating your own self-image. Were those found to be equally distributed among the general population, or did they tend to be amplified among those either in low economic strata or the very, very high economic strata, kind of the stereotype of the very wealthy person with an inflated self-image?
Yeah, nobody's done that yet. So we see the rising inequality of narcissism over time across studies. But most of the studies are of high school students and college students. So I don't think we have enough evidence yet. We do see more schizophrenia in more unequal societies and more psychotic symptoms as well. Fairly generally distributed. But all of these data they're clumsy. They're averages. They're not taking into account the fact that different subgroups in the population might react differently. That's all to come.
So with this data right here, I guess what I being from America, I guess what I'm confused about with counties in the states and more rural areas having poorer health, life expectancies, poorer health outcomes. But there seems to be sort of a discrepancy between platforms between the political parties, right? Where we have people like Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders offering universal health care, whereas Donald Trump and the Republican Party seems to be arguing very much against that. So do you think that there's something beyond health care and health metrics that's sort of weighing into this? Because you would think if communities are having poorer health metrics, they would maybe be pushed towards a more universal health care system given the way that health care is working, privatized health care is working.
That's very rational.
Right.
That, you know, if you yourself are experiencing poor health and you live in a community that has worse health, that you would vote for parties or politicians that were promising more healthcare. I think often, though, we see voting tendencies not linked to people's expectations of things being better. You know, it's true with who voted for Thatcher. The poor voted for Thatcher in vast numbers, even though her policies were actually going to make their lives worse. So I don't think people are always rational or aware of what they're thinking about. I think what we're seeing here is that sense of communities feeling they have been left behind. I'm not thinking necessarily that if they had more healthcare, they would be better off.
That healthcare is a bit of a rare herring, actually. Yeah. I mean, healthcare is really important when you're really poorly sick. It's really important in the last year of life. It's really important in very serious illnesses. For population health, healthcare is not that important.
Materials, which we don't need it for. There's a lot of studies of HIV infection rates in relation to inequality, infant mortality rates in relation to inequality in low-income countries. And I mentioned just before the study from Latin America that found that economic growth only produced health benefits when the benefits of that growth were more evenly distributed. For lots of things, we don't have great data. Life expectancy is pretty good. Most countries do well in collecting those data. Things like infant mortality, other mortality, deaths get recorded, usually correctly. Other things are harder. So for mental illness, you've got far fewer countries that have got robust measures of population health and mental illness. For social mobility, it's small as well. So some of it is data-driven, but some of it is also policy-driven, really, because low and middle-income countries have different policy needs than we have in the rich, developed market.
Challenges of looking for analyzing aggregate data is that the observations that you might find at the group level may not be seen individually. So how are you controlling for ecological fallacy or your biases associated with that?
Well, we haven't particularly bothered, but that's because other people have. So there are lots of multi-level studies of income, education, social class at the individual level, within societies, and then measuring the inequality at that level. There was a meta-analysis of income inequality in relation to health, physical health, that did that multi-level thing of controlling people's incomes and found that statistically significant contextual effect. And more recently, there's been a meta-analysis of those sorts of studies in relation to mental illness as well. So, yeah, the data are there. We know that within a country or a society, income matters a lot, education matters a lot, social class matters a lot. We have social gradients in health and well-being according to income and education class. But when we look across different societies, we can see that the inequality actually puts something else on top.
Would you say that there's a correlation between levels of government expenditure, levels of taxation, levels of government borrowing, and inequality? In other words, are countries that have higher levels of public spending, higher levels of taxation, less unequal than those that have low levels of government intervention?
It's not as simple as you might think. So Japan spends very, very little publicly. You know, it has very, very low social spending compared to the Nordic, Scandinavian countries. America spends a huge amount on healthcare, but doesn't reap healthcare benefits. There are analyses of what are called welfare regimes, you know, different kinds of welfare systems that have some relationship. But there's quite a lot to think about the causality there as well, isn't it? So if you have a society that at some point in its history chooses to have a high taxation, progressive taxation, high welfare regime, then people might buy into that in the future and keep doing it because they're seeing the benefits of it. Certainly, I think what's really clear in the UK is that since 2010 and the imposition of austerity, we have seen our public health statistics plummet. We haven't got a rising life expectancy anymore. It's flatlined, and in fact it's deteriorated for some people. Our infant mortality rates are up, it's not a crystal clear picture.
Hi, you mentioned earlier that this data is so produce really impetus policymakers to make any real change, hence setting up a charity. And that seems information was quite surprising because it's got shocking stuff and bulk of data. So I was wondering maybe like if you have any ideas why maybe they're so indifferent to this starting data. Was it because they doubt the empirical findings?
Politicians.
Or people who can change things. I suppose politicians would be the obvious people. I don't want to live with the group. I mean, so
well, I'm supposed to be really careful tonight about what I say about politics, because I am the chair of the board of charity, and we're not supposed to be talking about politics in the run-up to an election. But what I will say is that some political parties and some politicians within parties being receptive to what was said and others not being. And I think you need to think hard about vested interests. I used to think that if we just showed this evidence, particularly the fact that everybody is affected by inequality, then people would want there to be change. And that didn't happen. Then I thought, well, if we can show that their children, you know, even the children of the rich, are adversely affected by living in a kind of equal society, people will do something about it. But they don't, and I think, I think our politics in the UK, in the USA, are very dominant by people who would not think this was a useful agenda for themselves. I'm not telling you how to vote.
Any other questions?
You mentioned that epidemiology is an observational discipline. So the information you present to us is essentially a snapshot in time. Thinking about the way in which our understanding about climate change has evolved, and discovering the influence of feedback loops, and looking at that chart, I'm wondering how what goes on in the USA may affect what happens in Switzerland, or what happens in the West may affect sub-Saharan Africa.
Yeah.
Do you have any understanding of whether there are any feedback loops that you have identified, and how they might work, and whether we should go looking for them?
A little bit. So, I mean, we can see that if we look across time, over the 20th century and 21st century, we can see that inequality started to rise with the adoption of neoliberal economics in the USA, in the UK, and then that spread. And so sort of everybody kind of followed along. And so we got a huge rise in the inequality that hasn't really been unpicked since. But that's about it. I mean, one of the problems is we don't have long enough looking back data on income inequality or wealth inequality for enough countries to really think about that. But I think you're right that there are climates of opinion and politics and economic policy that sort of spread throughout the world. I think we're on the cusp of swing away from that neoliberal dominance. More and more economists, development experts are also looking at the world differently. I don't know. We don't have enough data or analysis of that kind.
Okay, then I have one question for myself.
great fortune of being married to my co-author and colleague Richard Wilkinson, and he had the great fortune of being taught by Karl Popper at the London School of Economics, who taught that it's perfectly fine to be biased or preferential in your hypotheses and in your thinking, but your methods must be objective and must be sound. So that helps. My own discipline of epidemiology and public health has always been an activist one. So that helps too. I think most of us who do research, we don't do it just because we're curious. Most of us do it because we want to make the world a better place. And that means we have to be activists and act on our evidence when it's appropriate. And too often we're expected to be objective, balanced, nuanced, not say you should do this, you should do that. Sometimes it's just enough. It's just enough stuff to make you feel you should actually go out there and try to make a difference. Do both.
Can I just say, here in Cambridge, you have a local group called the Cambridge Commons.
Oh, no, I'm so sorry, I should have mentioned
it. We have a meet-up on the first Wednesday of the month, and we talk about these issues as they relate to Cambridge, which actually, according to the Centre for Cities, was found to be the city with the highest level of inequality in the UK.
Thank you, George. That's really good to say, yeah. So the Equality Trust has local groups throughout the UK and internationally. Cambridge Commons is